How are you today? Hey, fantastic. Welcome to this Sunday morning at Quimper Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. One quick question before, or not question, one request before we start, and that is if you have a cellular phone, we're going to ask you to put it in airplane mode, because we are going to be flying all around the place today. And we want to make sure that we land the plane well. So please turn your ringers off or turn your phones off. Welcome you to be very, very present here this morning for a really special service. Whoever you are, wherever you're from, whomever you love, and whatever your faith tradition, please know that you are welcome here. My name is Joseph Bednarik, and I have been a member here at Quimper Unitarian Universalist Fellowship since 1999. I also have the great good fortune to occasionally speak from here, a place called a free pulpit, and I want to assure you that I take that responsibility very seriously, and I will put forth my best efforts today to stir your heart, to perhaps prompt some thoughts, and at best have you end the service pleased and happy that you spent some time here in this place that we're co-creating called Sanctuary. And I'd like to begin this service by acknowledging that the water, the land, and the shorelines here in Port Townsend, Washington are the traditional territory of the Sklallam and the Chemekum peoples. We want to honor and acknowledge our indigenous members and neighbors, and we want to vow to help restore and sustain these homelands. And we also encourage everyone here to engage with, to know where it is, to engage with and travel some of the Chichmahan Trail, which will provide you some more insights into local indigenous histories. And as we call in our time together, let's settle our minds, calm our hearts with the ringing of our chime. Love to hear that sound sort of vapor off. For today's service, we have an incredibly special prelude. This is Peter Meyer's Everything is Holy Now, performed by Kathleen Croston and Otto.
I was a boy each week. Sunday we would go to church, pay attention to the priest. He would read the holy word, consecrate the holy bread. Everyone would kneel and bow. Today the only difference is everything is holy now. Everything is holy now. When I was in Sunday school, we would learn about the time Moses split the sea in two, Jesus made the water wine. I remember feeling sad that miracles don't happen still, but now I can't keep track, 'cause everything's a miracle. Everything, everything, everything's a miracle. Wine from water is not so small, but an even better magic trick is that anything is here at all. So the challenging thing becomes not to look for miracles, but finding where there isn't one. When holy water was rare at best, it barely wet my fingertips. But now I have to hold my breath, like I'm swimming in the sea of it. Used to be a world half there, heaven second rain hand me down. But I'm walking with a reverent air, 'cause everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. Read a questioning child's face, say it's not a testament, that'd be very hard to say. See another new morning come, say it's not a sacrament, tell you that it can't be done. This morning outside I stood, I saw a little red-winged bird shining like a burning bush, singing like a scripture verse. It made me want to bow my head. I remember when church let out, how things have changed since then. Everything is holy now. It used to be a world half there, heaven second rate hand me down. But I'm walking with a reverent air, 'cause everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now. Everything, everything, everything is holy now.
Thank you very much. Oh, that song just gets me every time. Please join me now for the chalice lighting words. These were written by Michelle Obama. One light feeds another. One strong family lends strength to more. One engaged community can ignite those around it. This is the power of the light we carry. And our opening words this morning, a single sentence by Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. Faith is not clinging to a shrine, but an endless pilgrimage of the heart. Now I'd like to invite Pat and Doug Rodgers forward, who will lead us in our call to community. Hymn number 298, Wake Now My Senses, Please Rise in Body or Spirit.
Wake up.
Line of that song. That was fantastic. So this morning's sermon is entitled Nina Simone's Gum. And if that freaks you out, you're welcome to leave now. And it's going to focus intensely on how we humans are meaning makers, how we create meaning, especially in regard to religious relics. And our responsive reading this morning is all about meaning making. It's the concluding poem from Gregory Orr's book called Selected Books of the Beloved, of which I believe some people here were part of a poetry reading group that involved that book. Please note that these lines are presented as prose and in no way accurately reflect the line breaks that the poems have. So please forgive me, Gregory Orr, for this poetic sacrilege. And we were going to read the last line together as a group. This is what was bequeathed us, this earth the beloved left, and leaving, left to us. No other shore, only this bank on which the living gather. That and the beloved's clear instructions, turn me into song, sing me awake. And now I'd like to welcome Francis forward to introduce a very, very special time for all ages.
Hi, my name is Francis. At Quimper Camp this year, me and my sister Eleanor offered a make-a-movie activity. It was so fun how many people wanted to be involved. In 4 hours, we created a plot, characters, filmed, and showed our movie at the talent show that night. Our movie is called Curtis's Clue, and it's a murder mystery comedy. I hope you enjoy.
Thank you. is tea astounding.
Oh, great heavens.
The police! Who murdered who?
You dragged Don Curtis in. Let's just do ransom. Are you the murderer of poor Curtis?
I was simply bringing Miss Scarlet her towel when I stumbled upon Curtis incapacitated or worse. I just brought the body here because I thought you ought to know.
In my opinion, I think dead bodies are disgusting.
In my day, there was a spoon war and
commander of everything. I was the general, and I got traumatized.
I mean, I hated her in high school, but that doesn't mean anything.
Or did it?
I didn't experience the spoon war, but I experienced
okay, I'm not getting anything interesting out of this.
Of course I didn't commit murder. I don't even go anywhere near Miss Curtis.
If anyone would have committed the murder, it would have been my sister Scarlet. I would not go anywhere near her.
One simply does not murder someone. Why are you here?
I am too dignified to murder someone with a spoon. I know someone who would, though.
You're the one that's gonna have the most scoop on this, aren't you?
I'm waiting.
I've been hired to say, back from the dead for five short minutes, Miss Curtis!
Who killed me?
The guy with the tea? Or perhaps the butler? Miss Scarlet! Other Miss Scarlet?
Actually, it's Ruby.
Miss Black? Miss White? Mr. Green? Professor Plum? Maybe even Miss Peacock?
Colonel Mustard!
The Sheriff!
I'm a policeman!
Attitude check. And Dr. Fern! And last but certainly not least, Bo!
Who's Bo?
Who's Bo?
Yeah, who's Bo?
I have no idea who that man is. I've never met him in my life.
I know who Bo is, but I'm not telling anyone.
So do I.
What do you have to say for yourself, no, murderer?
Yeah, sounds like a Bo thing.
He's lying! Oh.
Mass murderer are under arrest!
And I'd do it again!
No! You're going down!
The tea is now cold.
That's a really stupid way to end the game. I mean, it's not supposed to have a happy ending.
Murder mystery?
Oh,
running after the knowledge. You gotta get it somehow. I think you got to slow down.
I can't wait till award season. That was fantastic. So if we could all form an arch along the center of the aisle, we will now sing our children off to class.
Go now in peace, go now in peace. May the spirit of love surround you everywhere, everywhere.
Quimper Camp filmmakers, what a group. You guys have a future. Well, they left, but they have a future in filmmaking and acting. It was wonderful. What we'd like to do now is acknowledge and welcome those of you who are visiting us for the first time this morning. If you are online with us, you're invited to say hello in the comment section and tell us your name and where you're from. If you are attending in person, please rise or raise your hand so we may welcome you. Welcome, and welcome to everyone. We're glad you're all with us today. We will now receive the offering, which today is split between our local Jefferson food banks and QUUF. If you'd like to donate today, you have a few options. The ushers will now come among you and receive the offering from those of you in person. You may also text the amount you'd like to give to the number now showing, donate via our website, or mail a check to QUUF with offering in the memo line. We will now gratefully receive your offering as we listen to Kristin and Otto Smith play a jazz duet by Stephen Jackman.
Please don't start till the music starts.
Thank you.
The musicians are really bringing it today. This is fantastic. Thank you so much. That was gorgeous. Also, just to watch them communicate with their eyes and watching that smile flash over Otto's face. And what I'm enjoying right now is the fact that I think I might leave this service with some sunburn on my bald spot. I might actually have to put a rag over my head. Anyway. Gosh, what are we doing now? Let's do announcements. What do you think? Yeah. All right. So I'd like to first invite Julia Cochran up for an announcement, and then Virginia Nixon will come up after that.
Hi. I am here from the nominating committee, and I can't see anyone because of the sun. Oh, well. After the service, 15 minutes after the service, a candidate forum will start. There are going to be index cards available to put your question on and give to nominating committee members at the sanctuary doors. So go get coffee and cake or whatever. There's all sorts of stuff out there. And come back into the sanctuary. Please don't put your cup on our chairs. If you need to put your food or drink down in the sanctuary, please put them on the floor. And come, and I'm going to ring that really big bell. What a wonderful good morning. I'm Virginia Nixon, and I'm here to remind you that in 2 weeks, on the 18th, after our Sunday services, there will be a Kate Kenny Irish Tea Party. We will share coffee, teas, and lots of goodies. It's our time to offer official thanks to our Kate as she completes her pastorate with us. We will also have some fun with limericks you write and bring and read, and enjoy a little music. Look for more details in the Friday updates. Also, please stop by the bulletin board straight out there in the foyer and add your name to the list of volunteers and food donors. There are still some slots to be filled. I am especially grateful for Kate's originating our new Wild Church program. We assemble every fourth Saturday under the huge Douglas fir at Fort Townsend. Then we spend time alone in nature and come back and share experiences. With leadership from Katie Taylor, it has been truly inspirational. Come join us. You'll see all of this described in the Friday updates. Thank you. It's winding.
Yeah, it's pretty intense. So we're now going to share our joys and sorrows, recognizing that our personal joys and sorrows are only a fragment of those joys and sorrows of the larger community of life. And thus, we're going to place this first stone, thinking in particular of that horrific train crash and the victims in India. And now within the congregation, a candle of joy for Victoria Poling and her ordination in this sanctuary yesterday afternoon, and how a Unitarian Universalist minister emerged from this congregation. And we light this candle for Toni Vincent this Saturday, June 10. Toni will be celebrating her 88th birthday. I know. So Toni, we wish you lots of love and lots of peace. And you can find Toni in the fellowship hall after this service. And now we place this final stone, holding in our hearts the joys and sorrows that I've just shared, but also thinking of the joys and sorrows among us that are unexpressed, but of no less importance. And I invite you into a time of silent meditation. Our special music today is The Road Home, based on an old American folk tune sung by Doug with Pat on the piano.
Tell me, where is the road I can call my own, that I left, that I lost so long ago? All those years I have wandered, oh, when will I know there's a way, there's a road that will lead me home?
So I do have a request. If there is someone out there who has a hat, seriously, I'm going to be very uncomfortable in about 10 minutes. Oh, thank you. Fantastic. Excellent. Oh, wow. Man. You know, you might think I'm the black-hatted man, but actually I'm the pink sparkly guy. Welcome to a Unitarian Universalist service. Right on. So, Nina Simone's gum. I read those words on the cover of a recently published book and I thought, what? So I looked closer and discovered that there was a quote from the iconic musician Nick Cave, words printed in very small type on the front cover that read, "Warren Ellis has turned this memento, snatched from his idol's piano in a moment of rapture, into a genuine religious artifact." Now, what is the equal sign between the three words Nina Simone's gum and the three words genuine religious artifact? So, sufficiently intrigued, I bought the book, and then I opened up to the dedication page, which read, "For our teachers." And it seems like a perfect dedication for this sermon for our teachers. So the story that inspired this book is this, and I cribbed it from the dust jacket. In July of 1999, Dr. Nina Simone gave a rare performance as part of a music festival in the UK. After the show, in a state of awe, the musician Warren Ellis crept up onto the stage, took Nina Simone's piece of chewed gum from her piano, wrapped it in her stage towel, and then left the premises. Now, the gum remained with him, carefully protected. It became a sacred totem. It became his creative muse. It was growing in significance with every passing year. And 20 years after that rare performance, a fellow musician and bandmate Nick Cave, who we referred to earlier, asked Warren whether he had any object that he would like to contribute to a display in a forthcoming exhibit called Stranger Than Kindness. And Warren realized that time had come to release the gum from his personal possession and to share it with the world. So together, the two musicians agreed that the chewed gum should be displayed in a glass case like a holy relic. And worrying that the gum would be damaged or lost, Warren decided to first have it cast in gold and silver. He also did a 3D imaging of it and tried to figure out if he could construct a building in the shape of Nina Simone's gum. In the book, Nina Simone's Gum, it reveals how something as insignificant and disposable can form beautiful connections between people. It's a story about the meaning that we bestow upon objects and experiences and how those things can become imbued with spirituality. It's a celebration of the artistic process and the incomparable power of art, of friendship, of understanding, and of love. It is an absolutely fascinating book, and I was totally seduced. And the book, with its suggestion of religious and spiritual meaning, inspired me to think about and consider religious relics, what they are, how they came to be, if I quote-unquote believe in the power of relics, and how far I might travel in body, in mind, and spirit to engage a holy relic. So, growing up Lutheran, I had no formal religious instruction regarding the importance and the power of relics, because holy relics, essentially, they weren't important. Lutherans, in trying to reform the Catholic Church, and reform being the root word for the Reformation and Protestant Reformation, Lutherans had a direct relationship with God, and they didn't need any intermediaries. They need saints or priests or relics or indulgences for that direct relationship to exist. For Lutherans, holy relics were essentially ignored because God was, you know, he was on speed dial through prayer. And it made no difference whether the person calling or dialing was an impoverished peasant working in the fields or an exalted priest. God's phone rang and God picked up. And I realize that the illustration isn't perfect because the Protestant Reformation predates telephones by centuries, but we get the gist. So you fast forward from Lutheran Sunday school as a young teenager to being in San Francisco on a business trip in my late 30s, where I had my first and very profound experience with religious relics. A friend and I were strolling through Chinatown, lazy, lazy Saturday morning. We were ultimately destined to go to the labyrinth at Grace Cathedral. I have a soft spot in my heart for labyrinths. And during our Chinatown stroll, we stumbled upon a poster that was stapled to a telephone pole that informed us that the, quote, Holy Shrine Relic Tour was in town. And in fact, these sacred Buddhist relics were only a few blocks from where we stood. And since fate brought us to this moment of perfect alignment of place and time, we considered that a sign from the universe, and we decided to visit the relics. So we walked to the Sun Yat-sen Memorial Hall. And once there, we discovered that there was this very long and winding line of people moving slowly into the deeper recesses of the building. There were bilingual signs in Chinese and English asking that prayers and blessings be made to bring peace to the world. Now, this was 2003, and the world was under a great deal of stress. We were in the midst of hot wars. There were high alerts from terrorism. The Taliban had just blown up the massive Buddhas of Bamiyan, showing the world that sacred art carved into mountains was not sacred to everyone. As my friend and I entered Memorial Hall, we were handed an English language brochure that read, quote, relics are the remains of beings who have devoted their entire lifetime to virtuous spiritual practice dedicated to the welfare of sentient beings. Every part of their body and remains carries positive energy to inspire goodness and reduce negativity. Due to the power of the relics, anyone who sees, hears, touches, or even thinks of the relics, receives their blessings. Consider yourself blessed this morning. And the flyer concluded, quote, most of us have delusions, and the holy relics can purify even the heaviest negative karmas created by us in countless lifetimes. So, keeping our place in line, and moving step by step ever deeper into Memorial Hall, it became quite apparent that we did not really know what we had gotten ourselves into. Something very profound and holy and alien was going on right before our eyes. I started to feel uncomfortable, as if we had transgressed into some sacred space that wasn't ours. I don't enjoy much being a tourist, especially a spiritual tourist. I prefer the rigors and the discoveries of genuine travel. But that said, we trusted. We kept moving along this long, winding line toward an elaborate altar and the relics, toward a monk, lama, sitting on a platform. This holy man was blessing pilgrims and elders and young folk. I was moved. I could feel tears well up in my eyes. Something was happening in me. Candles were flickering. The light reflected off the Buddha, this golden Buddha. I thought of the Buddhas of Bamiyan and the pile of rubble that their massive bodies had become, and how that rubble, each small fleck of sandstone, could become a holy relic. Perhaps enough relics for every human being on Earth, an Earth that had very heavy negative karma. Now the line kept winding, moving forward, and finally, I arrived to face these small dishes, these glass vials of relics, and apparently the bone fragments of enlightened beings. And to be honest, I really didn't see anything, though I was feeling plenty. The line kept moving past this elaborate altar toward a living, breathing, holy person, a monk, a lama, I don't know, who was offering blessings to those who approached. Now, at this point, I felt extremely conflicted, simultaneously curious about what was this feeling, but also feeling like I am not where I should be. I considered getting out of line, and then I saw two children approach the monk for blessing their water. And the monk puffed some air into these cheap plastic bottles, and then he smiled. And so just consider that and hold that for a moment. Cheap plastic bottles containing and holding blessed water. Now there's a metaphor if ever there was one. And finally it was my turn. The random spotting of a poster stapled to a telephone pole brought me right here, to this moment. So I stepped forward, I was given some instructions, I placed my palms together, I bowed, and after what seemed like hours, the holy person touched my head. And for me, just the swirling of emotions, tears welled up, but simultaneously, brain at full whirl, wondering whether I belonged, wondering whether I had the right to be present there, at this elaborate and holy place, temporarily constructed in a community center. The monk blessed me, and I accepted his blessing. The relics blessed me, and I accepted their blessing. Now, it seems to me that the lesson is that sometimes we need to calm our intellects and allow the flickering candles, the shimmering Buddhas, the blessing monks, and the holy relics to do their work, to move beyond the gates and the walls and the doors and the traps of who, what, where, when, why, how, to quiet the mind and to experience a different conscious space. And when my friend and I walked out of the building, we saw this van with a sign on the luggage rack, "If no anger, then no enemy." And it remains one of my favorite if-then statements. If no anger, then no enemy. So having been thusly blessed, we made our way to the labyrinth at Grace Cathedral, and we had another emotional, what I will call spiritual, experience, though that is a story for another time. This story is about Nina Simone's gum. And it is a legitimate question to ask. Do I believe that Nina Simone's gum is a holy relic? Second quick story. Last year I was in Santa Fe, New Mexico for a business trip. Smoke clouds from these intense forest fires were billowing over the mountain ridge. The phrase "world on fire" came easily to mind. One day down in Santa Fe, I had the afternoon off, so I typed the phrase "Santa Fe relics" into my favorite search engines and discovered that within a mile of my hotel, there was the Cathedral Basilica of St. Francis of Assisi, which contained a reliquary. And I love visiting cathedrals and allowing the cathedral architecture to work its magic over me. And once inside that glorious space, I took my time to feel into the place, to get settled, to watch the sunlight stream through the stained glass. I visited each of the paintings of the Stations of the Cross. And eventually I found myself at the reliquary in the presence of nearly 24 relics, including a piece of Mother Teresa's hair, a bone chip from St. Francis of Assisi, a piece of the Blessed Virgin Mary's veil, And most astonishing to me, this little Lutheran boy, a piece of the Holy Cross, so-called True Cross. Now, most of the relics were displayed in special containers made of metal and glass with finely crafted symbols and artistic effects like sunbursts. I slipped a few folded bills through a donation slot. I lit two candles, took a flyer describing the relics, snapped a few photographs. And then in looking over the brochure, I noted this sentence printed in bold on the lower back panel. The church, capital C church, the church approves honor being given to the relics that with reasonable probability can be considered authentic. Now that phrase, with reasonable probability can be considered authentic, seemed like a huge exit ramp to me. Well, sitting in a pew, next to the font that burbled holy water that spilled into a baptismal pool, there I was. There I was, in a cathedral in the high desert, forest fires billowing smoke, listening to water burble and fall, astonished, truly astonished, to be near a sliver of the true cross, the cross that was used to brutally crucify a teacher named Jesus for our teachers. Now that little piece of wood would have been over 2,000 years old. The piece of veil from his mother, the Blessed Virgin, would have been over 2,000 years old. Sunlight flaring through the stained glass, and then it happened. I witnessed with these eyes an elderly woman dip her fingers into the burbling water and cross herself. And soon thereafter, an elderly man did the same. Now this water, no doubt, flowed from the city's pipes, the same water that flowed into hotels and homes, restaurants and wading pools. And this water, in this cathedral basilica of St. Francis of Assisi, was blessed and was holy. Believers dipped their fingers into the holy water and performed a ritual that has been repeated billions of times over the past 2,000 years. My guess is that many of us here have repeated that ritual. And I recall the Buddhist monk from the Heart Shrine relic tour, that San Francisco building, blessing water. And I didn't dip my fingers into the font because Catholicism, it's not my religion. I did return to my hotel room and did some research online with the search term True Cross. And I discovered, to my astonishment, that I could buy a sliver of the True Cross on eBay for the starting bid of $1,000. Now, this seemed to reinforce the phrase, with reasonable probability, those relics can be considered authentic. And every Catholic and fallen Catholic that I talk with in preparation for this sermon told me a story about their engagement with holy relics, always mentioning a healthy skepticism of the veracity of the relics. I said, yeah, you know, you can buy a piece of the Holy Cross on eBay for $1,000, I'd say. Exactly, they would tell me. Which, to close, leads us right back to the holy relic of Nina Simone's gum. Now, objectively, this piece of gum chewed by an iconic musician is simultaneously worthless and priceless. They could not get the gum insured for the exhibit. The original piece of gum was on display last summer in Montreal, in a place called the Hall of Gratitude, as part of an exhibit put out by Nick Cave called Stranger Than Kindness. And I went with my family to see the gum and to be in the presence of its power. This single piece of gum, complete with teeth marks and a backstory, sat atop a little marble stand. It was tastefully lit within a recessed cabinet fronted by bulletproof glass. Now this gum and its museum-like quality of presentation a both absurd and a glorious monument to human creativity and meaning-making. This gum, this little piece of gum, can be rationally dismissed out of hand as refuse. And I use refuse intentionally, both as refuse and refuse. This gum refused, or it could be treated as a holy relic. Now, perhaps our rational minds could also refuse holy water in the high desert, bone chips from enlightened beings in Chinatown, blessed water in cheap plastic bottles, the true cross on eBay, or rubble from the Buddhas of Bamiyan at the base of a mountain in Afghanistan. And I am present before you today in lots and lots of sunshine, the sparkly hat, that the pilgrimage to Montreal brought me face to face, or perhaps better stated, heart to heart, with a holy relic. And I did as instructed so many years ago in Chinatown. I gently placed palm to palm. I bowed. And with my heart and my mind opened, I waited for whatever blessings might flow for our teachers. Amen. I lost my space. What are we doing now? Are we doing Nina? Yeah. All right. Fantastic. What we get to do now, what we all get to do, is rise in body or spirit. We are going to be playing a recording of Nina Simone singing one of our hymns. The words are going to be broadcast on the wall, and you are invited to joyously sing along with Nina.
Cause I know, yeah, not saying, cause I know.
is holy. Please join us now in the words as we extinguish our chalice. We extinguish our flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, the fire of commitment, or the power of transformation. These we carry in our hearts until we're together again. Our next week is the official year-end volunteer appreciation service, and Kate Kinney is going to be speaking on the topic of honoring the light. She's going to have a lot of it to honor. We hope that you can join us. And our postlude today is a ragtime called Sweet Pickles by George Florence with Pat at the piano. Thanks.